prince, where Chana is paying obeisance. In the forest, Siddhartha cut his hair as close to the roots as possible, symbolically severing his ties with the secular world. Bidding farewell to Chana and the faithful horse, he asked the servant to tell his father and family not to grieve for him. In this Borobudur carving, a heavenly being waits to receive the turban and hair. Here the hair is carried to the heavens, where it will be venerated. Apsaras and gods dance with joy as Siddhartha's hair is enshrined in heaven. The royal umbrella in the center shades the hair and turban, now objects of celestial reverence.
Siddhartha abandoned his princely life and became a religious wanderer when he was 29. For the next 6 years, he was known as Gotama, the ascetic. In his search for the truth and deliverance from suffering, Gotama first sought the guidance of two famous teachers. He mastered their instruction and meditation techniques, but he was not satisfied to remain at their levels. Gotama aimed to achieve the greatest possible goal, the complete conquest of suffering. He decided to leave his teachers and to set out alone to practice asceticism in a secluded area called Uruvela. Gotama was soon joined by five other ascetics. One of them was the same Brahmin named Kondanya, who had predicted that Prince Siddhartha would become a Buddha. The five hoped to learn from Gotama. He fasted more and more strictly. It was commonly believed that no spiritual attainment was possible without torturing the body. Gotama made an extraordinary effort, practicing all forms of the harshest austerities. His youthful body became a skeleton, but the more he punished his body, the further his goal receded from him. Without having attained enlightenment, he was at the point of death. The god Saka appeared before Gotama and played on a three-stringed lute. When the first string was plucked, it was so loose the sound could barely be heard. The second string was so tight that it snapped, but the third produced a beautiful, melodious note. Gotama understood that neither the sensual life of the palace, the loose string, nor the severe life of an ascetic, the tight string, could lead to enlightenment. Instead, he had to seek a middle way, free of extremes. A young woman, Sujata, came upon the starving Gotama. She offered him a nourishing meal of rice cooked in milk, served in a golden bowl. Restored by Siddhartha's gift, Gotama realized that his 6 years of searching had given him little. In this carving at Sanchi, Siddhartha makes her offering to Gotama, represented by a Bodhi tree, a common symbol for the Buddha. Seeing Gotama accept the food, his five companions misunderstood and concluded that he had given up his quest. Disgusted that he had broken his fast, they deserted him. Having finished his meal, Gotama walked to the Narinjara River. He tossed the golden bowl into the river, requesting that if he were certain to become a Buddha, the bowl should float upstream. The bowl did so and vanished from sight. It came to rest in the underwater palace of the Naga King, joining a stack of three other bowls which had belonged to three previous Buddhas. In this Burmese plaque, we can see the bowl floating upstream, the stack of four bowls, and the Naga King sleeping in his palace. According to legend, this Naga awakens only when a Buddha appears in the world. On his way to the place he had chosen for meditation, Gotama met a grass cutter named Sotya. Gotama accepted a gift of grass from him. Spreading the grass under the Bodhi tree, Gotama seated himself in meditation, facing east. This diamond throne in Buddhagaya marks the exact spot where he sat. Gotama made a vow to himself, "Even if my blood dries up and my flesh and muscles waste away to nothing, I will not leave this seat until I have perfectly achieved the goal of finding for myself and for mankind a way of deliverance from all suffering." Gotama concentrated his mind in the search for ultimate truth. Mara, the evil one, was worried by this threat to his power. Mara realized that if Gotama managed to escape his net, he could save not only himself, but also countless others. Mara's first strategy was to send his three daughters, Discontent, Delight, and Desire, to distract Gotama and to destroy his concentration. Gotama did not even notice their presence. His concentration could not be broken. Failing at this temptation, Mara led his ferocious army of devils and monsters to attack Gotama. They assailed him with weapons, magic, earthquakes, storms, and lightning. Throughout the tumult, Gotama remained calm and undisturbed. He was protected by the power of all the innumerable virtues he had practiced in his previous lives. The arrows shot by Mara's army turned to flowers. Mara then offered to make Gotama ruler of all the world if only he would give up his quest. Gotama claimed that he had already achieved more than anything Mara could offer. In desperation, Mara demanded proof of the Bodhisattva's virtues. Stretching forth his right hand, Gotama touched the ground with his middle finger. He called upon the earth to witness to the virtuous deeds he had performed through past eons in fulfillment of the exalted perfections. Suddenly, Mother Earth herself appeared to testify to the Bodhisattva's supremacy. She wrung out her hair. This released a great flood which swept away Mara's army. Surrendering, Mara and his generals paid respect to the conqueror of illusion. In this carving at Sanchi, Mara's army is retreating on the right. On the left is celestial rejoicing at the victory. As the full moon of Vaisakha arose, Gotama entered the tranquility of meditation. He acquired the power to recall all his previous existences. Then he became aware of the past and future births of all creatures. He could see the chain of karma of all living beings. Just before dawn, he achieved insight into the true nature of existence. He understood the three marks of dukkha, anicca, and anatta, suffering, impermanence, and the absence of a self. He completely destroyed all mental defilements. Perfectly enlightened by his own efforts, he became the Buddha.